may take a seat, brothers.
Daniel capítulo 6.
Daniel chapter 6.
No vamos a leer todo el capítulo.
We're not going to read all the chapter. You're going to have to do that at home.
Pero es el comienzo.
But it's the beginning of the of.
El libro de Daniel habla como él viene del cautiverio.
It says how Daniel came out of captivity, King Darius, the beginning of his reign and the experience that he had with him. And then when his son goes to the throne, Belshazzar, that was rebellious to God, he cuts his kingdom and he gives it to those of Persia, and King Darius is the first king placed by the Persians. And it says in the verse 13, something happened with Daniel, and people rose up against him with jealousy, and we're going to read. So, they answered and said before the king that Daniel, who is one of the captives from Judah, does not show due regard for you, O king, or for the decree that you have signed, but makes his petition three times a day. And the king, when he heard these words, was greatly displeased with himself, and set his heart on Daniel to deliver him, and he labored till the going down of the sun to deliver him. And these men approached the king and said to the king, "Know, O king, that it is the law of Medes and the Persians that no decree or statute which the king establishes may be changed." That was their law. Once it was there, there was no possibility to change it. So the king gave the command, and they brought Daniel and cast him into the den of lions. But the king spoke, saying to Daniel, "Your God, whom you serve continually, he will deliver you." Then a stone was brought and laid on the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it with his own signet ring and with the signets of his lords, that the purpose concerning Daniel might not be changed. Now the king went to his palace and spent the night fasting, and no musicians were brought before him. Also, his sleep went from him. Then the king arose very early in the morning and went in haste to the den of the lions. And when he came to the den, he cried out with a lamenting voice to Daniel. The king spoke, saying to Daniel, "Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, whom you serve continually, been able to deliver you from the lions?" Then Daniel said to the king, "O king, live forever. My God, sent his angels and shut the lions' mouths, so that they have not hurt me, because I was found innocent before him. And also, O king, I have done no wrong before you." Now the king was exceedingly glad for him, and commanded that they should take Daniel up out of the den. So Daniel was taken up out of the den, and no injury whatever was found on him, because he believed in his God. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! And the king gave the command, and they brought those men who had accused Daniel, and they cast them into the den of the lions, them, their children, and their wives. And the lions overpowered them and broke all their bones in pieces before they ever came to the bottom of the den. Then King Darius wrote to all peoples, nations, and languages that dwell in all the earth, "Peace be multiplied to you. I make a decree that in every dominion of my kingdom, men must tremble and fear before the God of Daniel. For he is the living God and steadfast forever. His kingdom is the one which shall not be destroyed, and his dominion shall endure to the end." He delivers and rescues, and he works signs and wonders in heaven and on earth. Who has delivered Daniel from the power of the lions? Hallelujah. So this Daniel prospered in the reign of Darius. Say with me, prospered. Prospered. Come on, Avivamiento, where are you? Say it, prospered. In the reign of Darius and in the reign of Cyrus the Persian. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It is a very known passage, especially for the children. We tell them the stories about David and Daniel and the Gospels and the miracles of Jesus. But Daniel will always be on that list. In the Second World War, the testimony of an American soldier in Japan was impressive. In the Japanese field, a soldier was in combat with his fellow soldiers, and the combat had just started. There was so much smoke that he was lost from his group, from his battalion, and he was by himself. And the Japanese would come by thousands to where he was. And in his anguish, the only thing that occurred to him was to go into a cave, an area where there were many caves. It was a mountain. It was a place where there was a lot of mountains, and he hid there in a cave, and he was shaking because he was so afraid. And these Japanese would go into each cave, and they would search American soldiers, and they would find them, and they would kill them instantly. And this soldier was hearing this and watching it from afar, how they would go inside and they would take a couple of soldiers and they would kill them. And he was there very afraid, and he could not leave, and he would say, Lord, send your protection. Lord, deliver me. Deliver me. Send an army to save me. He thought, if the battalion comes back, they're going to deliver me. God, answer me. And suddenly, a little spider appears. And it comes from the rocks, and it makes its first thread of its spider web and goes back in the second thread of its spider web, the third, and he would say, Lord, I'm asking you for an army, and you send me a spider. And the spider would go up again and up, and this man shaking, while in each cave they would come in, they would take out the soldiers, they would bring them, and they would execute them by firearm. And he was shaking, and no one would come to his help. And the little spider was there making a spider web. When the Japanese came to where he was, and he knew that it was the end, he knew it was the end. They went to go in, and the commander said, stop, can't you not realize that there is a spider web there? If an American would have gone in, he would have broken that spider web, and they went to the next cave. God protects us. God protects his children. Not like we think he is going to do, but as he, in his wisdom, knows how to protect his people. Hallelujah. There is a protection promised for all of us from God. We are En una roca firme. In a strong rock, a firm rock, protected by God. We are like Lord Jesus Christ said in John 10, in verse 27, we are in the hand of the Lord, and no one can take us from His hand. You and I are under divine protection. There is a wall surrounding us. Maybe we do not see it, but it is there. Satan sees it. You don't see it, but the devil cannot touch you. And you might say, where does it say that? Read your Bible. Read the book of Job. He was prosperous. He had a numerous family. God had prospered him in everything. But the scripture says that Satan came to the presence of the Lord, and God said to him, have you not seen my servant Job? There is no one like him. He is just. And I said, yes, but it's because you have protected him. Have you not fenced him with protection in his house and everything that he has? And the work of his hands and his possessions have increased in the land. That is what God does for the believers. He places a wall, a fence, and there is no devil that can touch us. He fences us, and he cannot touch your life, nor your household, nor your goods. But inside that fence, inside that wall, is God blessing you and prospering us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But when God takes that fence, because there is a time in our lives where that wall disappears for a moment, and Satan comes in and you feel alone, unprotected. And there is no man. It's like expression. There is no human way to do it. There is no one who can help you in that time. There isn't a hand of a human being that can be able to deliver you. When you are in that condition, you think that God has abandoned you. That's why we sang that song. And when you think that Jesus has left you, when the Lord has left you, don't fear. God will never abandon you. When He takes that fence, is because He wants to take you to a higher level. It's because He wants to bless you even more. Read the book of Job. He was someone before, but after He took that fence, He was a new person with double the blessing. He will increase your blessing. Those that are going through troubled times or a struggle, let me tell you what the Lord has for you. God will increase your blessing. God will increase your blessing. God will increase your blessing. Wipe your tears. God will increase the blessing. Hallelujah. The struggle in our faith, it's just a trampoline that impulses you to go to new places. In Daniel's case, Prophet Daniel, he had done everything right. The king saw that he was superior to the rest of the other governors that were there. He had placed 120 governors to reign throughout the whole world, and all of them would give accounts to him. One of them was Daniel, and the king was thinking about placing Daniel above all of them to be the second in that kingdom, that worldwide kingdom. And when the others knew and found out about this, because out of jealousy, they found a way to destroy him. And just as we read not even the king could help him. But the hand of the Lord was there to protect him, to deliver him. And then his enemies, all of them, went to the lion's den, and he was delivered of his enemies. And the Bible says Daniel prospered all the reign of Darius, even in Cyrus the Persian's reign. When he was taken out of the lion's den, when you are taken out of the lion's den, you're just going to go up the rest of your life, the rest of your life. Not just one day, the rest of your life.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. What was the secret? What was Daniel's secret? Yesterday, amidst a troubled time or struggle that Anita and Juan Sebastian were telling us, I was reading this minutes before it happened, and that's what was speaking to my spirit, Daniel's secret. Say it with me, Daniel's secret. This is what I want to speak to you about, Daniel's secret. Everyone wanted to know, what does this man have that since he came here captive? Captive is basically a slave. He has had a favor in all the reigns and kingdoms that have come. It's good that you can have grace with one president or king, but he had favor after favor with king after king. What does he have? What does he have that he is superior to everyone else, according to what Daniel 1 says? He was even 10 times more superior, more wise than the wise men of the kingdom. So they place him as one of the wise men of the king, and then they place him as the boss of those wise men, and now they want to place him so that he can reign over the whole world. What does this Daniel have? What is his secret? His enemies wanted to know his secret so that they could destroy him. They have always wanted to know what the secret is. The unjust always want to know what the secret is. If you see the last magazine, they speak about what is the secret to the revival. They want to know what the secret is. When Samson was alive and no one was able to detain him and stop him, he was able to king a handful of Philistines. Everyone wanted to know what was the secret of his strength. I'm going to tell you two things of things that we have a right to. He was consecrated to God. When he came from captivity, he came to Babylon captive. He made a decision to consecrate himself for God. That's the secret. And that's the secret of Samson. Samson was consecrated to God. Do you know, he didn't cut his hair because it was a vow. It was a Nazareth vow. Jesus was from Nazareth because they believed that he was born there. That's why they would call him Jesus of Nazareth. But this was Nazarene. It's a vow where they took, I'm not going to cut my hair because my life is consecrated to God. That's the life story of Samson. That's what Delilah cut his hair so that she could break his consecration. And the second thing is that they were filled with the Holy Spirit. What Darius found was that he had a superior spirit. And what they found in Samson, it was that the Holy Spirit of God manifested in himself since he was a young man. The Spirit of God was the secret of Daniel. And you and I have those two secrets. The first one, we are consecrated to the Lord Jesus Christ. We are consecrated. That's why we take our babies and we present them to him. Lord, we consecrate our children to you so that they could be yours. And they can love you and they can serve you. We are consecrated. When we gave him our lives, Jesus, come to my life, save me forgive my sins. I will follow you. I am consecrated to the Lord. We are consecrated to the Lord. We are consecrated to the Lord. Hallelujah. The second thing is that we have the Holy Spirit. We have the Holy Spirit, and if some of you don't have Him, then ask for Him, because the Lord says, "Giving you shall receive, seeking you shall find, call and the door shall be open. Everyone who calls and asks shall receive it. Those who ask for the Holy Spirit, the Father will give Him to you." If you say, "I need to be filled with the Holy Spirit," lift your hands and say, "I want what Daniel had. I want what Samson had. I want who they had, the Holy Spirit. Fill me, Lord." Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So they could not fight against this. They needed to know what was the key that he had, Daniel's secret. They knew that he was consecrated. They could not stop him. They found out that he was a man filled with the Holy Spirit. They could not do anything against this. But in their investigation, they found out that Daniel would pray three times a day. Listen to me, Avivamiento. I'm giving a key to you that will take you from glory to glory, from victory to victory. This was the summary. The governors came, the satraps, and they said, "This is it. He prays three times a day to God. He makes his petitions. We cannot defeat him unless that it could be because of that." Listen to me, the ministers of God. That is where the devil can defeat us, because you are anointed, you are consecrated. But if he can take you from that place of prayer, that is where you can lose there in the enemy's battlefield. The place of prayer. Please don't come yet. Stay in your seats. All the country, all the churches in the countries want to know what Daniel's secret was. Say it with me, Daniel's secret. So they said, if we accomplish for him to stop praying three times a day, if we can make him to skip a beat, we are going to be able to overcome him. And they found in a law, and they spoke to the king, and they said, "Be careful." I'm going to say something. "Be careful, my brothers, those that have leadership, because sometimes they touch that string and they make that note sound, the one that they want." King, all of us, the governors and satraps of your kingdom, we have decided to ask for you to make a law, so that no one can make a petition to no God and to no king, but all to you, the world king of Persia, and the whole world, and everyone's going to ask only to you. And they made him sign the law. And the persecution started. They were seeing what Daniel would do, what he would do, and they discovered him. He, it says in the Bible, would go into his house, he would close the door, he would open his windows to the land of Israel, and he would kneel down and he would start to pray to God three times a day. They surprised him and they took him imprisoned to the king, and they said, "King, you signed this law. No one can pray to a God different than you. And Daniel prays and makes his petition three times a day. And the law of Medes and Persia says that it is irrevocable. And he has to go to the lion's den. That's the story of Daniel. But that's the secret. And what I can perceive is that you have not taken it yet. But before I finish my message, I hope that all of you can have taken this for yourself. All of you have the Holy Spirit. All of you are consecrated. But this secret that took him from glory to glory was in his secret place. He would close his doors. He would open the windows. And he would pray to God. In his secret place is where the blessing is. That is the victory of the things that you have outside. Closed doors, open windows. Are you understanding the secret? Ask Pastor Patty how many times pastors of all the globe ask what the secret is. They come, and the secret for us is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the secret of this revival. But they ask, what does the pastor do? What does Pastor Badi do? The secret place. We have our secret place. The secret place. Avivamiento, clean your eyes and your ears. It is the secret place. It is the prayer. It is that time with God. It's that time with God. What is the secret? Why has Avivamiento gone from glory to glory, from triumph to triumph? We are consecrated. It is the Holy Spirit in the secret place. The secret place. May no one take you out of there. May no one take you from that time. Disconnect your phone. Disconnect your TV, your computer. And open your windows, and God will prosper our ways, our path. Hallelujah. The Lord Jesus taught it to us. He gathered his disciples, and he put this word in writing in the Gospel of Matthew and of Luke, and it says, when you pray, go and close the door, pray to your Father that is there in the secret. And your Father who sees in secret, he will himself reward you openly. Those that are in the secret will be rewarded openly. God will make you prosper. And those that seek God, he will bless your path. When he says here in this word, he will reward him. He will reward you openly. It is he will prize you. It seems that when someone dedicates time to speak to God, God says that I will reward him. I will prize him. I will bless him. What was the secret? What can we do to be like Daniel? He was in the secret, and the word was fulfilled. God rewarded him openly. Hallelujah. It's always been there in the scripture. He said the same thing about the widow. In the Gospel of Luke, chapter 18, a widow came to the judge day and night so that he could do her justice. And he said, I'm going to do justice, not so that she could wear out my patience. And he said, look what this unjust said. Hear what the unjust judge said. And shall God not avenge his own elect who cry out to him night, day and night to him? He will soon do justice to us. What did that widow have that she got what she wanted? Day and night she would cry. That is the secret of the blessing of that widow. Hallelujah. If a friend comes to you at night and says, give me bread because a friend has come and I have to give to him, and he's not going to say, no, I can't because I'm slipping. No, he will give him the bread because it is his friend. But if he does not give it because he is his friend, he will give it because of his, because he cried out. That is what moves the heavens, because God is our friend. And when you pray to him anytime, he will rise up and he will give you because you are his friend. And he lifts up because you're because of your importunity. Close doors, open windows. When God takes that fence to a person that seeks God, when God takes his protection, it's not that God has abandoned you, it's that he's using the devil to rise you up. He's using the devil to place you higher. That's what he did with Daniel. He took a bunch of problems from his hand. First of all, he took his enemies. Because in spite he went to the lions, then God protected him. God protected him. And later, they placed in that den all of his enemies. But you know that if they had just placed his enemies, maybe the wives of the enemies would have persecuted them. So the king placed there the satraps, their wives, and their children as well. We're speaking about a pagan king. We're speaking a pagan king that made that decision to take that problem away from Daniel forever. And God will do the same with you. God has not taken that protection. He will use the devil, and the devil will come against you, and you will be up and without any enemies. And that's what happened with Joseph, with Sennacherib. God took that protection, and he prayed, and God took all of his enemies. And that's what's going to happen with you. You're going to pray, and God is going to defeat all of your enemies. You're gonna rise. You're gonna look up, and there's not gonna be sickness. There's not even gonna be a seed of that sickness. There's not gonna be a threat of divorce, but a household consecrated to Jesus. Your children will not go in the wrong path. They will be radical and firm in Jesus. God will end with your affliction. There will be no any more ruin, but abundance of God. Hallelujah. And God will be exalted. God will be exalted. I patiently waited for the Lord, and he heard my prayer. I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined to me and heard my cry. He brought me up out of the horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock and established my steps. God will be glorified. God will be glorified when he takes you out of that place. That is the push of God. That is the push of God. We didn't want to leave from the 76th Street when we had the venue there. And we had lawyers, and we felt that God was not protecting us. No, that's a lie. God brought us to the land of revival. God is going to take you there, from there to the land of the blessing. This is the secret. Closed doors, open windows. Closed doors, open windows. All of those that say, I am of Jesus, I have the Holy Spirit, I have that secret. Closed doors, open windows, and God will take you from glory to glory. You will prosper in this government, in the next government, in the one after that one, to your right, to your left. It doesn't matter. You will prosper. You will prosper.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yeah.
Oh, those that are in anguish, go back and wait in him. Come back because he has done you good. Return to your rest, O my soul, for the Lord has dealt bountifully to you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. My brothers, we cannot grow weary. When that trouble time comes and that struggle, there's a solution. Close doors, open windows. Daniel, when they made that law, the Bible says that he closed the door, he opened his windows, and he did it three times as he always did, three times a day. Do not surrender. Do not give up. When there's nothing to do, you have God. You have God. I believe you heard what Ana Maria just said in Juan Sebastian, but you also have to hear our version, because when they called us, they would scream and they would cry, and we did not understand what was going on, and we weren't able to understand until suddenly Juan Sebastian was able to speak, and he said Michelle fell on her head and she is not reacting, she is not speaking, she is rigid, she is not breathing. It's been 2 minutes, and I said, did you give her mouth to mouth CPR? And she had not reacted. What can you do there? You can't call the doctor and take them to the clinic. It's too late. There was nothing to do with her. But we could do something. Pray. We hung up and we placed a scream and we said, Satan, we rebuke you. Get your hands off our grandchild in Jesus' name. And Patty, on the other side, she started sending messages to our family, everyone praying. She was crying and she could not even speak. Everyone praying for Michelle because she's dying. We couldn't do anything else. I had to come down because no one could understand anything. This is what we sent to the ministry. I'm asking you that you could be praying for Michelle. She fell and she's not reacting. She has not woke up. Everyone praying, Don't answer me, just start praying. This is the only thing that we were able to do. You have telephones, everyone praying. But you know what I liked? That everyone stopped what they were doing and they would start praying. Alvaro said to me, I went on my knees and I cried out like I never did before. Arno said, we were eating and we threw everything. And people would look at us in the restaurant and we started praying, Lord, save Michelle's life. That is what you have to do. You have to stand up and start praying. The doctor can help you, not the rich man. Your family member can help you, but there is someone that can help you, and that is the Lord, the one that can help you. Lord, lift up. And he will deliver you from the lion's den, and he will place you in overabundance. Hallelujah. And I'm saying to you, Juani and Maria, God will take you higher up. God will take you higher up. Yesterday, you wasted all of your energy. They cried out, but glorious days are coming for you. Glorious days are coming. Come on, all of us.
Return to your rest, O my soul, for the Lord has dealt bountifully with you. Return to your rest, O my soul, for the Lord has dealt bountifully with you.
Yeah.
if I do not believe that I would see your salvation. Sentinel in the morning, that is how I wait in you.
I would have lost heart unless I have believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Trust in the Spirit of the Lord, for He will perform great things in our midst. He will raise you up. And probably, as in the example that the pastor told us, you may see anguish, you may see death, destruction, ruin, scarcity. But you have the assurance that God sees. You know, the most beautiful thing of God is that He defends us. But in His way, not in the way you expect Him to defend you, not with your own weapons, not with your own strategies, nor not in the way you want it to happen. But I tell you, if something is sure, is that answer is close, is that the victory is sure, certainly the one who dwells under the shadow of the Most High can have the assurance. You can have the insurance and the rest that He goes with His wing. Under His wings, you are protected. That on His lap, you are rested. So probably you may see torment. You may see darkness and the night. And I tell you, today you see darkness and night. But tomorrow, His light shall dawn and shine upon your house. He shall shine upon your life. Give a great applause to the Lord. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Most High, of the Almighty. Thank you, Lord. Waits for the Lord more than those who watch for the morning. Yes, more than those who watch for the morning. I would have lost heart unless I had delivered that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Turn to your rest, O my soul, for the Lord has dealt bountifully with you. For the Lord has dealt bountifully with you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I do not know.
I don't know why or what battle you are going through or struggle, but I'm talking about you critical times. In the lion's den is not something that you can see. Let's see how this year we can escape the lion's den. No, when you fall there in those nets that you think will destroy you, the only solution is prayer. What I'm talking about, what happened to us yesterday, it's not a game. It was minutes, seconds. Look, Patty's message, look what she sent. Look.
Family, all of you, I want you to pray. Mama fell down. She doesn't react. She is fainted. Please, everyone praying. We are going to pray, priest. I ask you, this is urgent.
She didn't say, look for a good doctor, look for the best surgeon. No, everyone praying. All of us praying. You could be crying, but all of us praying, because there is our victory. Closed doors, open windows. And our blessing is going to come from the Lord. My deliverance comes from the Lord. Father, I ask you for all these requests. Lift up, Lord. Yesterday we prayed at our house, but what better than to pray in the house of the Lord? Thank you because you are our deliverer. Thank you because you are our justice. Thank you because you fight our battles. Thank you because who else could we run to? Because only you have words of everlasting life. Only you.
Return to your rest, O my soul, for the Lord has dealt bountifully with you. Return to your rest, O my soul, for the Lord has dealt bountifully with you.
Hallelujah. Let's give that great applause to the Lord. Come on, those that are children of God, say it out loud. You are my deliverer. You are filled with the Holy Spirit. You are consecrated. But the key that makes that fence a protection is closed door, open windows. Closed doors, open windows. Let's pray to Jesus and let's give a great applause.